The road to Buddhahood is open to all. At all times, all living beings have the germ of Buddhahood in them. There have been many Buddhas, and there are many more to come. It is generally agreed, though, that the last Buddha was Siddhartha Gautama. There are many versions of the Buddha's life story. According to a Buddhist text of the 5th century AD, there once lived a man named Sumedh. He met with Dipanka, who was Buddha, many eons ago. Sumedh said that he wished to become a Buddha. He became a Bodhisattva, one who seeks enlightenment, and went through many incarnations, perfecting himself in each life. For his final incarnation, he chose as his mother Queen Maya, wife of the king of the Shakyas in Nepal. His final birth was miraculous.
It's said, I don't believe this myself, but it's said that this birth was, well, it's been called a very auspicious birth. And there's various, it's told in various different ways, but one of the descriptions is that she had the Buddha to be, the baby, standing up holding a tree. And, well, there's one version has that he came out of her side, out of her right side. And another version has that she stood up and, again, holding this tree. And she was on her way to her mother's court, I should say. So it was just in the middle of the journey, the birth suddenly happened. And another version has that she died there and then while holding the tree. There's another version that she was absolutely fine and went back to her palace because she never got to her mother's, which actually in India is a traditional way of doing it. The wife goes to her former home to have the child. So who knows quite what to believe. I don't believe he came out of her side, and I don't think many self-respecting Buddhists probably do believe that, but that was one of the mythical tales, you could say. But overall, I think all Buddhists believe that it was an auspicious event that he was born. So, and at that point he was called Siddhartha, Prince Siddhartha.
When he was about 30, he left the court and his wife to live the life of an ascetic. After 6 years, he found enlightenment while sitting beneath a banyan tree of Bodhigaya.
It does seem that it was quite a tremendous event, from whichever account you look at. And he did definitely feel for himself that he'd understood something that hadn't been understood in this era before, but that he also intuited it had been understood by Buddhas in the past. So, and at first, shortly after that, he was wondering whether it would be possible to teach. The accounts say that he felt very alone after he'd just realized this great truth, and he thought, but it's so profound, it's so hard to see, who on earth is going to understand? And for a while he thought, well, he wouldn't teach. But then he realized there were certain people quite further advanced on the path, particularly the two teachers who'd offered to share their communities with him. He thought, well, they might understand because they're quite close. So that was what he decided to do.
During the next 40 years, he taught, gathering around him a growing band of disciples. It is said that his teaching was a reaction against the teaching of the Veds and sacrificial practices.
It was a time of great experimentation in India at that time. There were an awful lot of spiritual seekers trying all sorts of things. Some were thinking that the route to salvation was through mortifying the flesh or somehow getting beyond the body. So there were quite a lot of people practicing austere practices like standing on one leg for hours on end or meditating in the at the hottest time of day, and things that were really quite painful, you could say. Eating very little was a common one. There were other people who were practicing all sorts of sacrificial practices, fire worshippers, animal sacrifice, different things like that. Or people into ritual purification through washing in rivers and so on. And again, the Buddha probably tried most of these, but he wasn't convinced that that these had any bearing on the mind or being able to see the truth. So he afterwards said that those were all different extremes, and what he taught was a middle way. Particularly he taught a middle way between the extreme of believing there was an eternal soul that carried on from life after life, or believing that this life was all there was, which is more a nihilistic approach. And that he said that there was something in between those. People currently believe there was either it all ended at death of this life, or it went on forever and ever. And he said, those aren't the only options. So in that sense, what he called his middle way between those two was really quite radical.
Buddhism became a monastic religion. About the 8th century AD, it came into conflict with Hinduism, following Muslim invasions from the north. Towards the end of the 12th century, Buddhist universities throughout India were sacked, and Buddhism almost disappeared. Buddhism survived because monks and travelers had taken the Buddha's teachings all over Asia. It has taken root in such countries as China, Tibet, and Korea because the Buddha's Dharma, or truth, appeals to everyone. There are no barriers of race or class in Buddhism, and it has been open to the influence of local custom and belief.
Buddhism seems to have adapted itself to many different types of culture around the world, but what doesn't change are its principles. How those principles are expressed does change in all sorts of ways, and you can see the host culture is used as a vehicle for expressing timeless truths. I think in particular for us in the West, it's important to see that we don't have to wear robes and go out with a begging bowl and shave our heads in order to practice the truths that the Buddha was teaching. Those are much more Asian accretions, they're Asian customs that aren't that relevant to really what he was teaching. And I think that's quite important because people can be off-put by the externals, but those aren't really what it's about at all.
The Buddha is perceived to be neither human nor God. He transcends the nature of both. His teaching offers a solution to the fundamental problem of the human condition. Nothing is permanent. Happiness doesn't last. There will always be suffering and death. This state is known in Buddhist teaching as dukkha. The first step on the road to enlightenment is to recognize this. There is nothing negative or pessimistic about this recognition. I teach only dukkha and the cessation of dukkha. Once the cessation of dukkha has been achieved, the Buddhist attains nirvana, the eradication of greed, hatred, and delusion. Buddhists believe a natural law governs the spiritual world as the material world is governed by physical law. This natural law is called karma. The law of karma states that every deed ripens with time. This will affect whether one's future rebirths are favorable or unfavorable. There is a moral and natural dimension to karma.
This is a very big and quite complex topic. One way you could sum it up is that actions have consequences. Everything we do, and that includes every thought we have and every word we speak, as much as every sort of activity or deed, will have an effect. It'll have an effect on our minds, and it'll probably have an effect on the outside world or other people. To say exactly what effect that has is hard to quantify or evaluate, but it is the law of cause and effect, simply. One thing leads to another. But often there's more than one cause for any given result. So it is very hard to break down into sort of neat examples, you could say. One analogy I quite like was the Buddha was saying that angry words will have will have an effect. I mean, every word has an effect. But he likened, if one throws a hot coal in anger at somebody, it will have an effect. And the first effect is that you'll burn your own hand before the person you're trying to throw the hot coal at. And that is an example of how one's own states of mind affect oneself as much as externally.
The Buddhist travels along the path leading to the cessation of dukkha by means of bhavan, or meditation. This is based on two methods, shamatha, or calm, and vipassana, or insight.
There are an awful lot of different types of meditation that the Buddha enumerated. I think there are 40 or thereabouts. But broadly, they're all aiming to develop awareness. And we use that awareness to understand the nature of the mind. So we don't use that awareness like the other practitioners of his day just to enjoy meditative bliss, although that might be a fruit on the way. But it's more to understand the nature of the mind and see more deeply into life. So firstly, developing awareness, that's the primary aim of meditation. And another very important aim would be to develop positive emotion, to be more kind, to develop warmth, friendliness, goodwill to all human beings. Well, no, not just human beings, to all beings, creatures and as well. So this isn't just a nice idea. It becomes a powerful meditation practice, and it's one of the practices we do, developing positive emotion and directing that goodwill and warmth and friendliness to all beings. This meditation practice is called the Metta Bhavana. Metta means love or loving kindness. And we systematically have a way of cultivating that. That's one of our primary practices in my order and in many other traditions. The other, possibly the best known of all Buddhist meditations, is called the mindfulness of breathing. And that's when you focus on the breath and observe it coming and going. And as you observe the breath coming in and going out, the mind is stilled and concentrated to an ever-refined point. And with both of those, they sound very different, but they become more and more similar the more one concentrates, the more one understands them. And both of those develop a very powerful, positive awareness of oneself and the world. And one uses this awareness to then try and understand more deeply the truths of life.
Both monks and laity undertake the five precepts, which are the basis of all Buddhist ethics. The first precept is not to take or destroy life. The second is not to steal. The third is to avoid sexual misconduct. The fourth is to abstain from false speech. The fifth is to abstain from alcohol and all drugs that cloud the mind. Monks and nuns must follow five additional precepts. They must abstain from eating and drinking after midday, from dancing and singing, from personal adornments, from using high seats or beds, and from handling gold and silver. After the Buddha's death, his disciples began to preserve his teachings. A council was held in what is now Rajgir. An established version of the Dharma was created. Rules of monastic conduct were drawn up. These were memorized and passed on orally. The only text to have survived in an ancient Indian language is the Pali Canon.
The Pali Canon is, you could probably call it the Buddhist version of the Bible. It's the oldest recorded teachings of the Buddha. Not actually written down during his day, but it is the earliest version that there is. So you have a large section which is about his teachings, discourses, stories and parables. And then you have a chunk which came a little later, which is code of conduct for monks and nuns. And then there's a third section which is more analytical, philosophical, which analyzes the nature of mind and Buddhist teachings.
In Japan, a different form of Buddhism developed, Zen. It is the form best known in the West, although fewer than 10% of Japanese Buddhists practice it.
Well, the Zen emphasis is on simplicity and meditation. It's strong on discipline. It reflects the Japanese culture that it developed or grew up in. Zen meditators, for instance, generally sit facing a bare white wall. So it's a more stark variation, you could say, on the Mahayana tradition that it grew out of. It emphasizes bringing spiritual practice into everyday activities. So it's about bringing awareness to the washing up, bringing awareness to brushing one's teeth. And in some cases, for instance, one of the well-known habits or practices is making tea, and the Zen tradition has made that into a highly elaborate art known as the Zen tea ceremony. So it's just bringing an enormous amount of awareness and attention to detail to what you could call everyday activities, and therefore imbuing them with, well, more satisfaction, making them more complete.
The name Zen means meditational absorption. Zen's founder is a monk called Bodhidharma. Legend has it that he sat in meditation for so long that his legs fell off from lack of use. Perhaps the best-known Buddhist in the world today is the Dalai Lama. Since the 17th century, the Dalai Lama has been the ruler and spiritual leader of Tibet. When a Dalai Lama dies, monks travel all over Tibet in search of a successor. This is usually a child. He is known by his ability to recognize certain religious artifacts. In 1950, the Chinese army invaded Tibet and tried to wipe out Buddhism. The present Dalai Lama, the 14th, fled the country and has lived in exile ever since.
Well, certainly from my own point of view, I think being a Buddhist in the modern West is about learning to make life seem more meaningful and more precious. It includes developing awareness, as I've mentioned, looking for contentment and mindfulness in any moment. So maybe that would be about living more simply. It's not about any particular lifestyle, as far as I'm concerned, but it is about the quality of that life rather than the external facts of that life. So it might involve not getting caught up in the rat race because of the mental attitudes that tend to go with that. But people and members of our order work in all sorts of fields and lifestyles. It isn't necessarily about that. It's about one's attitude, the attitude that you bring to any activity. I think it involves being faithful to friends. Friendships prize very highly in Buddhism and in our order in particular. It involves learning to communicate with all people, irrespective of race or creed or culture, because all beings are to be respected, respecting all life, I suppose. That's one of the fundamental principles. And also the Buddha said that every single being had the potential for enlightenment, regardless of your gender or race or creed, as I say. So that it's on that basis that we try and relate to everybody, that they have the potential for great wisdom and great compassion.
To Western eyes, Hinduism and Buddhism may seem the very opposite of all that is logical and rational. Yet many in the West have embraced them and found in them a source of enlightenment. They also continue to challenge the way we look at reality.